Hey everybody, thanks for joining me today, Dr. Ross Marcogiani, and another great Word of the Week. Today's Word of the Week, we're going to be talking about menopause. So we'll be talking about what is happening during the female's body when transitioning into menopause, what you should be looking for signs and symptoms of menopause, and then how we create a smooth transition to the second half of our life here. Let's dive in. Okay, so first, what is happening during this time, this transition into menopause? So obviously we have a drastic drop of estrogen and progesterone. So just so you're familiar, females, the first half of your cycle is going to be predominantly estrogen, and then the second half of your cycle is going to be predominantly progesterone. Estrogen builds up the uterine lining, the endometrium, and progesterone helps to maintain or hold the endometrium. And then when we have that drop in progesterone, as well as estrogen follows, then we shed the uterine lining. So what happens with the transition into perimenopause, that's the 12 months of no cycle or amenorrhea, not having a menses. So during those 12 months, you're going to be considered perimenopausal. Now you could go without a cycle for 6 months and then you have another cycle again. That would then be considered you have to start all over again and wait another 12 months to be clinically fit the category of menopause, right? So it's 12 months without a menses. And you can see here the big thing that happens is that the majority of our progesterone drops here from the production from the ovaries. So we have a decrease in FSH and LH. Those are signals from the brain down to the ovaries to decrease or slow down or stop producing estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. Now we still will produce small amounts, but significantly less than during cycling years. So that's something to be aware of there. And then what are some symptoms to be aware of? So typically, females are pretty aware of what symptoms are occurring. But some, you know, again, like hot flashes, night sweats, hair loss, we can have irritability, mood swings, severe brain fog, weight gain, dry skin, vaginal dryness. Some ones that females might not be aware of is that depression and anxiety can increase. We can have sleep disturbances. We can even have issues with the cardiovascular system and having heart palpitations and increased risk of fractures because we drop our estrogen. And estrogen has been shown to be helpful with maintaining bone health. So that's something to be aware of when transitioning into menopause is bone quality as well. Some things that we want to make sure we are focused on when transitioning into menopause. So once the ovaries stop the production of progesterone, estrogen, testosterone, or decrease the production, this places a increased demand on the adrenal glands, because the adrenal glands are what's going to take over to producing the majority of your estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. Now you will have some release of hormones from adipose tissue, because adipose tissues are like their own little organ itself. But we want to try to make sure the adrenal glands are functioning optimally so that they can handle that stress when we transition over to the adrenal glands producing the majority of your hormones. And typically what we want to look at here is your cortisol, your pregnenolone, your DHEA, your DHEA sulfate. We can also look at your aldosterone. We can also look at the signaling, your ACTH, your adrenocorticotropic hormone. Those are all markers that we'd want to look at for your adrenal glands. We could also run a diurnal cortisol rhythm. So usually it's either in urine or saliva. We take 4 samples throughout the day to see what your cortisol rhythm looks like as well. And you can see here, I just wanted to tie in how the adrenal glands affect and can take over and help produce with some of our sex hormones. You can see here on this chart, we have pregnenolone that we talked about. We have cortisol on here, aldosterone that we talked about. We have DHEA that we talked about. And you can see if you follow the arrows that pregnenolone can go into progesterone, that your DHEA can go into testosterone and further downregulate into estradiol, E2, or estrone, E1, which after menopause, estrone is your most active form of estrogen. And E2 estradiol is your most active form of estrogen during cycling years. So you just, again, ties the connection how the adrenal glands are tied in to hormone production. So we want to make sure that's being assessed. And then we also want to make sure thyroid function is being assessed. So the thyroid and the adrenal glands are tightly regulated together. They function almost on the same circuitry. You can see we have the hypothalamic pituitary adrenal axis and the hypothalamic pituitary thyroid axis. So you can see the first part of that, the H and the P, the hypothalamic and the pituitary, are both on the same system in regards to the adrenal glands and thyroid. So again, that's kind of what I mean when they're tied together. They run off of some of the same circuitry to make, you know, make a connection here. But you can see here, if cortisol is high, it can influence the thyroid. Also, therefore, if it's low, it will also influence the thyroid as well. And it can influence T3 and T4 production. So we want to make sure the thyroid is being checked out and making sure that we're supporting the thyroid as well during this transition to menopause. So we typically want to look at some markers here, obviously your TSH, thyroid stimulating hormone, your total T4, your total T3, your free T3, free T4, T3 uptake, your reverse T3, and then your antibodies as well, whether it be thyroid peroxidase antibody, thyroid globulin antibody, thyroid stimulating antibody, TSH receptor antibody. These are things that we want to make sure we're checking so that we have a smooth transition into menopause. And then how we want to create that smooth transition. So obviously nutrition is priority number one. So we want to have a healthy nutrition that makes everything easier, decreases our inflammation. But we also want to make sure we're looking at your adrenal function. We want to make sure we're supporting the adrenal glands, whether it's with pregnenolone, whether it's with DHEA, whether we're using adaptogenic herbs as like ashwagandha, rhodiola, ginseng, various adaptogenic herbs. We want to look at and make sure if we need to increase our cortisol that we're using licorice root. We want to make sure we're looking at the thyroid, assessing thyroid function, and if need, giving glandular thyroid to help increase thyroid function. Looking at making sure we have adequate iodine, adequate glutathione, making sure we're getting CoQ10 as well. That's helpful for the heart and the brain. It will help the thyroid as well. And then there's obviously the options of HRT, hormone replacement therapy. I would lean more towards trying to use a more natural-based hormone, whether it's from like Diascorea or gourd. These are plants that can actually be made into either natural progesterone, identical molecular structure of progesterone, and or some other herbs for estrogen as well. But I would lean more towards progesterone. If we start really messing with estrogen, that it can create some issues. And typically most women are estrogen dominant, even going into menopause and during perimenopause. So we do want to make sure we favor a little bit more to progesterone, but don't want to forget estrogen support as well. And then you can also do seed cycling here, using 1 tablespoon of ground flax, pumpkin, sunflower, or sesame seed. Now, it's shown that flax and pumpkin will help to increase your estrogen, and sunflower and sesame will be more progesterone-based. So there is some merit behind doing that, in the transition of menopause. That's a whole other topic if you want to seed cycle during cycling years to help a normal cycle or normal rhythm. But using some sunflower seeds and sesame seeds will help. Ground 1 tablespoon will help to increase some progesterone levels. And when we're looking at these numbers, we want to make sure, a lot of times if you look at the lab ranges for progesterone and estrogen, they're extremely low. And testosterone, they're extremely low. I typically try to have my patients be a little bit outside that menopausal range, even if they are menopausal, because I still want them to have adequate levels of estrogen and progesterone. And then another interesting study that I came across is PRP treatment, so platelet-rich plasma injections into the ovarian stroma to help increase premature ovarian failure. And actually, one of these cases, which you're going to see the link here below to, was a 40-year-old patient who had who was in menopause, who wanted to try to conceive again and actually did successfully. So not only will it help with premature ovarian failure, but again, it will help to increase and produce produce estrogen and progesterone to help that transition so that you're not completely crashing or bottoming out with your estrogen, progesterone, and testosterone. So I hope this video was helpful. If you're someone who is interested in getting these numbers looked at and making sure we have a smooth transition, please don't hesitate to reach out to the office. And if you know of anyone that can benefit from this information, please share this. I appreciate your time. Have a wonderful day, and Merry Christmas to all, and Happy Holidays. Thanks for your time, and have a good day.